السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. كيف أمسيتم؟ How are you this evening? أمسينا وأمسى الملك لله والحمد لله. لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له, له الملك وله الحمد. How are your hearts today? So-so. Amen. So-so. Remember, so far we have been talking about what concept? The ruh. And last time I basically gave you the last part that I wanted to share with you. There's more to be shared, but pertaining to sharing with you some most essential concepts, especially from the kitab, the book of the ruh of Imam Ibn al-Qayyim in particular, while we also benefited from the words and the works of many other ulama, rahmahullah ta'ala. I meant to cover that part. If you remember, and I hope you do, do you have any question pertaining to that? I'm going to spend no more than 5 to 10 minutes if you have questions. No question. Alhamdulillah. So remember, don't say you were not given a chance. So you have no question, everything is clear, inshallah ta'ala. But if you do, of course, in the meanwhile, some other time on the subject matter, I'm around, whenever I'm here in Salah, after every Salah, you're welcome to come and accost me and ask your questions, first come, first serve basis. Second, then, I'm going to take some of that time to remind you of something fiqhi and usuli fiqhi. And then I go back to matters of the soul, not from Kitab al-Ruh, but words of some of our great ulama and teachers, rahmahullah ta'ala, about our spiritual realities and our spiritual endeavors as they, radiyallahu ta'ala anhum, lived the Qur'an and lived the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, not only knew that, but they lived that. And they practiced that, and Allah gave them more clarity in that knowledge. So I just want to say something technical in fiqh and in usul al-fiqh, which we need, I think, to remind many people, many of us, many students of ilm, if we are students of ilm at all, we should be reminded of that, because there are other things that are also, that you are exposed to from other sources of knowledge that might not be absolutely correct and are not the only ones available. Namely, as we have learned, something to remind you of, as we have learned, when we want to know something in our deen, whether it is haram or wajib or mustahab or makruh or mubah or shart or rukn or batil or fasid, all of these, when we want to know them, what are the sources of our knowledge? Quran and Sunnah, right? That's what I have to keep repeating. Well, your answer is only partially correct. And in the circumstances in which we are, it is dangerous to think that way. The Quran is the primary source of knowledge. And that primary source of knowledge tells us that the Sunnah is a source of knowledge. So they become two primary sources of knowledge. First the Quran and the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. And the Quran and the Sunnah tell us that there are other sources of knowledge in our Sharia. So if something is not in the Quran and not in the Sunnah, it doesn't mean it is not proper or Islamic. It depends. Because, as a matter of fact, a huge bulk of our Islamic knowledge is extracted by the ulama from the other sources of knowledge, which we had learned a few weeks ago, namely the Qur'an and the Sunnah and the others, which are ijma', the consensus of the ulama in particular, and especially, or the ulama among the sahaba and so on and so forth. That's the details of the ijma' are something else. But it could be, the answer could be neither in the Qur'an nor in the Sunnah, but it could be in the ijma' of the ulama, or in the, through the process of qiyas, reasoning by analogy. Or it could be the result of, what have we learned? Istihsan, properly defined as a source of knowledge. Or it could be found in, throughout another source of knowledge. Istihsan we mentioned, what's the other one? Al-Masalih al-Mursala. It could be through the reasoning of Al-Masalih al-Mursala. Or it could be through the reasoning of, what else? Before that, okay, we mentioned that. Qawlu al-Sahabi, an opinion of a companion of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Or in, through the concept of saddu al-dhara'i', the blocking of the means. Or it could be in al-urf. Or it could be in shar'u min qablana, and so on. Why is this very important? And this is what the ulama of our schools of thought from 14 centuries ago, until nowadays, those ulama who are truly characterized and qualified as ulama, mujtahidun especially, this is essential. And you find all of them never saying, well, because it is not in the Qur'an, nor it is not in the Sunnah, therefore, ignore it. Therefore, it is haram or makruh, for example. Or that it is bid'ah or shirk or kufr or kada. No. They look in all the sources of knowledge. It's very, very important. So if we say, if somebody comes and says to me, Ya akhi, this is haram or makruh, for example, or bid'ah. And one would ask legitimately, if one is at least a student, some level of being a student of knowledge at some level, would ask the question, why, Ya akhi? Why is it haram or why is it makruh or why is it wajib or why is it mustahab or why is it halal, for example? Well, there are answers by the ulama. If he says, for example, well, this is haram, or this is makruh, because, for example, Rasulullah ﷺ did not do that at all. Or, no one of our salaf did that. This is, he said, well, this is why. Because we didn't find anything in the Qur'an and anything in the Sunnah, yes, nothing says it is prohibited in the Qur'an and in the Sunnah, for example, but look, if it were allowed, Rasulullah ﷺ would have done it. Listen to this argument. Would have done it. Or the Salaf would have done it. That's to many people, to the beginners. It sounds interesting, it sounds impressive, but it is not, neither interesting to the ulama, nor impressive to the ulama, because it is not a principle. That's something that some people developed as an argument and was spread and spread and spread until it became so prevalent that most people now, many people, you know, espouse it and repeat it. And remember those of you who attended the last seminars, we expounded on this a lot of details. But simply to remind you that that's a very improper argument. Because there are many things that Rasulullah ﷺ did not do, and the Sahaba or the Salaf did not do, but is neither haram nor makruh. It's either mubah sometimes or even mustahab. Or maybe even wajib. When the ulama use the other sources of knowledge and derive from that, that something is indeed like that. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not do every detailed thing that is good. Think about it. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not do every specific thing that is good. He told us to do everything that is good in general and in the Quran, but did he do everything specifically that is good? It's impossible. He's a human being. Yes, the perfect of human beings. And he did not do everything that is mustahab. He has been doing so many things, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to teach us. But he kept away from everything that is haram, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And that's why you know that there are many things that later in the time of the Sahaba or after them, that the ulama, through the proper reasoning, say it is halal, or it is mustahab, or it is even wajib, and it is neither haram nor makruh, later, on the basis of those other sources of knowledge. We gave many, many examples a few weeks ago. Who remembers some of those examples? Nobody remembers even one or two? Yes? For example, the famous example, of course, is Taraweeh. In what sense Taraweeh? Yes, it's good bid'ah. Who said it was a good bid'ah? Sayyiduna Umar himself said it is good bid'ah. Famous statement of his, what was it in Arabic? He didn't say good bid'ah, he didn't speak English. What did he say? No, he didn't say bid'ah hasan. That's the correct meaning, but that's not what he said specifically in the text. Now I'm hurt. That's why I have to keep repeating these things. Ni'matu. Ni'matil bid'atu hadhihi. Ni'matil bid'atu. Ni'mat. Like you say in Urdu. Ni'matil bid'atu hadhihi. What a beautiful bid'ah this is. What a delightful or a delighting, delightful bid'ah this is. Ni'matil bid'atu hadhihi. He said that about Taraweeh. What was bid'ah about Taraweeh? Bid'ah meaning new, something new. The word bid'ah is not necessarily bad or good. It depends. First of all, did Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam pray Taraweeh? Yes, he did. It's not no. Yes, he did. So, but how many days did he pray Taraweeh? 3 or 4 days. And did he pray Taraweeh the way we pray them by calling people to Taraweeh? No, actually he was performing Qiyamul Layl in Ramadan by himself, and people began to join him. He didn't say, come, let's pray Taraweeh. There is something called Taraweeh, let's pray Taraweeh. Let's do that. And then he stopped. No, he was praying Qiyamul Layl alone. And they began to join him. Some of them, 1 and 2 and 3, and then it became a jama'ah. And then they went home. The next night, he went for the same thing. He didn't say, come again next night. We're going to have Taraweeh. He just was performing his Qiyamul Layl. And then they joined him again. And the third night, he didn't say, come to Taraweeh. He didn't say that. So, and he was performing Qiyamul Layl, and they joined him again, and he led them, and he continued. And then the fourth night, or another night, what happened? He simply did not open the door. He did not come out to do that. And he said, this is it. And there are texts about that. The point is that he stopped doing that. And he did not start that in the way we're doing it. In that sense, it is. In that sense, it is bid'ah. It's something new. And what as is new is that it is done every night and everybody is invited and we are going to perform taraweeh. This is definitely bid'ah. Number three, that it continues the entire month, not 3 or 4 days. This is definitely bid'ah new. And not only that, that it is every Ramadan. This is definitely new bid'ah. And to assign, you know, certain things, and for example, 20 rak'at assigned to it in the time of Sayyidina Abu Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu arda. That's new, that's bid'ah. So it is bid'ah definitely in that sense. And yet, the companions who understood well what Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam meant, and what is a bad bid'ah, and a good bid'ah, and what is bid'ah, etc., etc., and what is haram, and what is makruh, they said, they all agreed, after Sayyidina Umar did what he did, they all agreed that it is a beautiful thing to do. نِعْمَةِ الْبِدْعَةُ هَذِهِ said he, sallallahu radiyallahu ta'ala anhu wa arda. That's the most famous example, and there are many examples. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam didn't do that. And yet it is neither haram nor makruh. It's even what? Mustahab. And all the ulama of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah say this is mustahab. They don't say this is sunnah actually. They don't say taraweeh the way we perform them is a sunnah, meaning practiced by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It is bid'ah. Bid'ah in the linguistic sense, it's something new, but it is a good bid'ah on the basis of what happened, what occurred in the mind and the heart of those ulama, scholars of the Sahaba with the leadership of Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu arda. So, and there are many, many more examples that we have, some of which we have mentioned last time. The point is, the argument that something is haram or makruh or bid'ah because Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not do that, nor the Salaf did not do that. That argument that is repeated by many people who did not think well or were told that's the way it is, and maybe when they grew up and they matured, they realized they were also wrong. That's not correct at all. So nobody should be intimidated by this statement. That's what I'm repeating, why I'm repeating it again and again. Nobody should intimidate anybody by saying it is haram or makruh or bid'ah because, and the only reason being that Salaf radiallahu ta'ala anhum or Sayyiduna Mawlana Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not do that. That's not the argument of the ulama. That's an argument that has spread, that some even before have used excessively, but that's not. The answers of which are like this, or the answers to which are like what we mentioned. So, now let me ask you a question. I'm going to test you. Quiz. Again, let me say, if one says, well, there's a question, is it halal or haram? First of all, in our deen, in our shara, there is not only halal and haram. Why do we make it it's either halal or haram? It's usually lay people of us speak like that. And some people who are in heart lay, and in intellect lay people, but we appear as like very scholarly. Because it's not only halal and haram. It's what? It could be halal, could be, but it could be makruh. Makruh. Makruh is ja'iz. Some say, ja'iz or not ja'iz? Well, it's not ja'iz. What do you mean by it's not jayz? You cannot do that. But that's not what the ahkam sharia are. Ahkam sharia are very haram, forbidden completely. If we do it, we're going to be punished. If we don't do it, we're going to be rewarded, inshallah. And there is also makruh. Makruh is, if we don't do it, we are rewarded. If we do it, we're fine, we're not punished. Which means it's jaiz. Makruh means it's jaiz, technically. But preferably, don't, because you're going to miss on rewards. And then there is also wajib, obligatory. If we do it, we are rewarded. If we don't do it, we are, if we do it, we are rewarded. If we don't do it, we are punished. And then there is mustahab. If we do it, we are rewarded. If we don't do it, we're not punished. It's okay. If we do it, we are rewarded. Remember the makruh. If we don't do it, we're rewarded. But if we do it, we're okay, makruh. Mustahab, if we do it, we are rewarded. If we don't do it, it's fine. It's jaiz not to do it. And mubah. Mubah, as you call it, permissible, is whether you do it or you don't, it's the same thing. You're neither punished nor rewarded under general circumstances. First of all, there's not only halal and haram. What happens to the other five? To the other three, I'm sorry. That's very important to keep in mind. Something may be said in the Quran or in the Sunnah even of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam that we should not do that. Don't do that. If it comes with this structure of the language, nahi, don't do that. But don't do that, as most people translate it, and teachers and kada kada, they translate it as what? Naha Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Naha. How is it translated usually? How is it usually translated? Pardon? Naha Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But probably some of you don't know because you're told only the translation and you take it for granted. Naha, it is translated as he prohibited or he forbade. See in the books and many translations of hadith and of fiqh. It's like that. You do read it like that if you don't know the technical Arabic. Then you want to read that. Naha does not mean it's forbidden. It didn't say harrama Rasulullah. Harrama, that's he forbade. He prohibited. But naha, it's the imperative command of not doing something. Don't do this thing. Don't do this thing does not mean in the logic of the Sharia language, does not imply it is haram necessarily. It implies two things possible. Don't do something may imply it is haram and may imply it is makruh only. And the ulama know when to distinguish between the two. When it is makruh and when it is haram. But many, many people of currently in fatawi, in books, translating nahi as prohibition, which is wrong, and implying that nahi means only prohibition. No, it may mean karaha. And there are many texts like that in the Sunnah of Rasulullah, where he says, don't do something, and the ulama know through the proper processes of analysis that it is makruh and not haram. That's why you find the books of fiqh filled with, they bring you a text, Naha Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and they say, Hada wa hada yadullu, yustadillu bihi ala al-karaha. And therefore, this implies that it is makruh. They don't say it is haram because there are other parts of the arguments that make them understand from this language that it means it is makruh and not haram. So this is very important. So let me quiz you, as I said. Someone says, well, he's asked the question, and he's supposed to be a mufti or an alim that people go to. People nowadays, we go to anybody. It's not necessarily we call somebody mufti, we call somebody alim. And that's we call each other that way. Allah knows who is worthy of those titles. And then, for example, if that person would say, well, ya akhi, because it is not in the Quran, it is not in the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, I couldn't find it in the Quran nor in the Sunnah that it is halal, therefore it is haram. It's neither in the Quran nor in the Sunnah. Therefore, keep away from it. You've used this argument. It has been used for you. You have accepted it. You have said it to others, true or false. Now, is this statement correct? Why is it not correct? Yeah, I think you said it good, but you said about 89% of it. Right. Exactly. So the statement that it is not in the Quran, it's not in the Quran, it's not in the Sunnah, therefore keep away from it, that's totally wrong. Because the ulama derive what is acceptable, what is haram, makruh, or mustahab, from the Quran and the Sunnah, and if not, and ijma' and qiyas and mustahsan and sadd al-daraya. Well, first of all, you don't ask anybody about ahkam. We ask the experts. We don't ask somebody who went to school for 4 years or 10 years, which you all do, and you hold anybody who goes to school, khalas, he's an alim. That's your fault also. The public. Ulama are ulama. A better answer is, I looked into the words of the ulama, the experts, as they dealt with this question, if this question has been dealt with, and usually the questions we talk about are old questions dealt with for 14 centuries. Yes, there are questions that are new, that require new ijtihad by those people who have the expertise of ijtihad, of new issues. But matters most of the time that we talk about are matters already dealt with for 14 centuries by thousands and thousands of ulama of great caliber. And they have dealt with that. So the best answer, the safest answer is what? When the ulama have said, as they looked surely at the Quran and at the Sunnah and at the Ijma and Qiyas and so on, they said, if they said it's haram, or it is makruh, then khalas, it is haram and makruh. If they disagreed between them, each other, then alhamdulillah, you may take either, because you're taken from sources of ijtihad. Unless you become yourself a mujtahid. Or this teacher who lives nowadays that you learned from in that masjid or in that school, he is a full-fledged mujtahid, and with his ijtihad, has a different opinion than the galaxy of all the ulama of 14 centuries, and still you prefer that. That's your choice. You'll be responsible for it. So that statement is incorrect. It to say, because it is not in the Quran and it is in the Sunnah, I didn't find it there, therefore keep away from it. No, no, no. That's what those of us who don't know do. The ulama would look at all of that and the other sources of knowledge with the processes of proper thinking, and they come with the answer. Now, the other question is, the question is, for example, is this wajib? Is this obligatory upon me to do? Or mustahab? Says, well, the wajib is what Allah said it is wajib on His Rasul. And the mustahab is what Allah said it is mustahab on His Rasul. And that person would say, Ya Akhi, and it is nowhere in the Quran, sometimes these words are repeated, it's nowhere in the Sunnah that it is obligatory or that it is mustahab. Therefore, keep away. Therefore, it is not obligatory, it is not mustahab. Is this a correct statement? Is this a correct statement? No? Why? Again, I'm just simply getting you to practice that very simply. Because the answer, assuming that that person is correct in saying it is not in the Quran, it's not in the Sunnah, sometimes it is. But people don't know or don't understand. But assuming it is not at all, then that doesn't make it, your answer to that in that way is wrong. Because the ulama have to look into the other sources of knowledge, such as ijma and qiyas and istihsan and sadd al-dharaya, masalih mursala, yani sharra man qablana, il istishab, etc., etc. So it's very important. Remember, I gave you another example. Who comes for Salatul Jumu'ah here? Raise your hands. Alhamdulillah, are we doing okay, Salatul Jumu'ah? Now, all of you coming to Salatul Jumu'ah in this masjid are committing a bid'ah, including myself. It is bid'ah, performing Salatul Jumu'ah in our masajid is bid'ah. But bid'ah hasana. Did you know that? Now you know, we talked about it, right? Good, alhamdulillah. But probably all don't know. Even some students of ilm, some imams and some don't know. And those who say almost everything is bid'ah, may Allah forgive us and forgive them all. Performing Salatul Jumu'ah in the masjid is... Yes. I like that that you find it curious and strange. I like that, because that's what it is. Strange and curious to say. But why am I saying this? Of course, from what I learned from the ulama, obviously what they have written and the history and the recording of the history. Because look, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the Sahaba did not do that. Did you know that? No, you didn't. In the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there were in Medina, how many masajid? Nine masajid. See, now we learned well. Nine masajid in Medina, in which the regular daily salawat are performed. Medina's not very big even those days. Big relatively then, but you know, nowadays Al-Masjid al-Nabawi contains all what Medina was and more. Masjid al-Nabawi, now the way it has been expanded, and jazakumullah khair for that, it contains all Medina that was inhabited and more during the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So when you go to Al-Masjid al-Nabawi, you're performing probably salah in the house of some sahabi, in the space where it was the house of some sahabi, of Abu Bakr or Umar, or many of them lived around the masjid, which was only the part that was the rawda, and some of it was the masjid of Rasulullah. The rest was was Al-Madinah. Now, but when it comes to Salatul Jumu'ah, he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam performs it only, they all perform it only in one masjid. Al-Masjid Al-Nabawi. Nobody was allowed or performed Jumu'ah in the other masjid. Only in Al-Masjid Al-Nabawi. That's why they're called Masjid Jami'ah. Masjid Jami'ah. تجمعوا فيه فيه تصلى فيه الجمعة. And that was the sunnah of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. He did not assign even textually, even by his words, nor did he practice Salatul Jumu'ah in other masajid. And so it was in the time of Sayyiduna Abu Bakr. And so it was in the time of Sayyiduna Umar and Uthman and Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhum wa ardahum. Until much later, some say it was in the time of the Abbasiyin, some historians. That for reasons of expansion and expansion and expansion, ila ayyadhalik, khalas. Some of the umara, some of the salateen, some of the khulafa, you know, established that, and the ulama agreed with that. The ulama found it on the basis of their scholarly knowledge and arguments, through masalih mursala, through istihsan in this case, and so on, they found it. Yes, it's something good to do. Who would say nowadays, who's going to say, in Medina and Munawwara, there should be only one Jumu'ah? That's why you go to Medina and there are Jumu'ah in Masjid al-Nabawi and in Allah Masajid and in Mecca. Who would say that now in Plano, Texas, nobody should pray Jumu'ah anywhere except in the IACC, which is the main masjid. Some would like it, right? But no, it's not proper Sharia argument. So that's a bid'ah. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not do that. But did not do it does not mean it's bad. He did not do it, it does not mean it's bad. If it is not specifically said, don't do that. And if the rules of Shara and the standards of Shara and the other sources of Shara also don't say it is prohibited, or they would lead to the conclusion that it is good to do. So please, this now it has, I know it has been embedded in our psyche for. Some of you are born in this. At least I was not born in this. I was a transition. I lived both. I'm a hybrid. Where this was not so prevalent, and the other opinions were there as well. And that one began, this began to be very strong, these attitudes, basically very strong, you know, recently, from the 70s on. But it started actually about, you know, a century and a half ago. So that I want to emphasize, my dear brothers and sisters. Something that is not done by Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam or by the Salaf. Our Sharia doesn't say, you don't do that. And logically, when Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam does not do something, logically, it only means, you said it earlier. You said it and someone else said it. Logically, when Rasulullah ﷺ doesn't do something, taraka Rasulullah ﷺ shay'an al-tark. Al-tark la yufidu al-tahreem wa al-karah. Tark does not imply it is prohibited, nor that it is reprehensible. Logically, it implies what? غير مستحب. Not necessarily. لأن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم did not do كل المستحبات. No. Logically, what does it mean? Original state. You're close with that statement if you mean what I think you should mean. Truly, absolutely. Now, all of that, and we said all of that, remember last time, and today I'm just saying a few things to refresh your memories, etc. But now the logic, logically, the logic of the language, implies, Tark, when Rasulullah does not do something as a legislator, and he was Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Sharia, Al-Hakim, Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala, Sharia, الحكيم سبحانه وتعالى ورسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم مشرع عن طريق الله سبحانه وتعالى. Of course. Now when the Sharia al-Hakim, the lawgiver, the legislator, does not do something, logically it doesn't mean we must not do or that it is bad. Logically it only means we ourselves may not do that. That's what it means. He did not do it means I also am allowed not to do it. He did not do it. The necessary logical conclusion that nobody should disagree with is that I too am allowed not to do it. I'm allowed not to do it. At-tarku yufidu jawaz at-tark. That's why probably if you meant by the original state, I thought, by the original state, this could be implied. At-tarku yufidu jawaz at-tark. That's all it is. That it is haram or makruh or kada needs other form of evidence and other forms of proof. And that's why we found out that Rasulullah ﷺ didn't do many things and they were not done. And later, or even in his own time, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, they were done. Because if they were haram or makruh, they would not have been done on the basis that he did not do. We mentioned at least two or three examples now, and there are hundreds of examples. That I want, inshallah ta'ala, to keep emphasizing to all my brothers and sisters, and to the students of ilm, and to those who are interested in ilm, and to those of us who think we have ilm. Please pay attention to this. Imams and teachers and scholars and students of ilm. This is what a vast majority of the experts of our ulama have said, rahimahullah ta'ala. And in our last, remember, seminar, we brought all the quotes you needed, which are not everything. They are only, what we shared with you is only part of what was said. Aina. Now something more spiritual. From those, rahimahumullah ta'ala, who lived their lives, as I said, lived their lives in ilm, rational power that they had, and the logic that they had, rahimahumullah ta'ala, and they had beautiful hearts, beautiful souls. Allah gave them the ni'mah of both. The ni'mah of ilm, and the ni'mah of ruh, the ni'mah of intellect, and the ni'mah of soul, beautiful souls. And this ummah of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam was privileged by having a very large number of people like that compared to the other ummah. Walhamdulillah. So bear with me as we share them just to tingle you and scratch gently your souls and your hearts, inshallah ta'ala, after we spoke of something on the head, which is important. Now we speak of something in the heart. He said, rahimahullah ta'ala, of them, one of whom, العلم إن قارنته الخشية فهو لك وإلا فعليك. العلم إن قارنته الخشية فهو لك وإلا فعليك. علم. What is علم? Knowledge. Especially this knowledge that we are dealing with. If it is accompanied with خشية. And where is the seat of خشية? Where is the seat, the place of خشية? It's the heart, inside. And what is khashya? Na'am? Akramak Allah ya bunay. May Allah bless you. Allah ennoble you. I will not drink it now, but I will really take it with me to drink it home for your barakah. And I will cherish it. Inshallah ta'ala. May Allah grant me that barakah. Khashya is awe and reverence inside of us. Not fear. Not fear is still legitimate, but khashya. You know, khashya is about something current. Fear sometimes, khawf, is about something futuristic to come. Ilm accompanied with khashya from Allah Azza wa Jalla. He says that is for you. Otherwise, it is against you. Knowledge by itself is not sufficient. As we say, it is necessary, but not sufficient. A lot of information, a lot of knowledge is good, but it might turn to be horrible to have all of that if it is not accompanied with khashya. العلم إن قارنته الخشية فهو لك وإلا فعليك. لذلك الله عز وجل said what? Do you remember something like this that Allah said? إنما يخشى الله. Not الله. Totally the opposite meaning. Ayah, that's exactly the ayah. إِنَّمَا يَخْشَ اللَّهَ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ الْعُلَمَاءُ. As Allah says, verily, those will have khashya from Allah who are ulama. And that's why the ulama who know this and practice that, they say, if someone lacks khashya in the heart, lacks khawf from Allah, lacks reverence for Allah, lacks adab with Allah and good akhlaq with Allah, that person, no matter how much he or she knows, is not the alim. And there are many reasons why as well, many other beautiful things that are said. Do you know, some of you who know perhaps some of the history of our ilm, of ilm al-hadith, some of you have heard the name Shu'bah ibn al-Hajjaj, rahimahullah, Imam Shu'bah? Shu'bah, no? Some have had Imam Sha'di, Sufyan al-Thawri, Ibn Uyayna, Ibn al-Mubarak, any of these? Well, Shu'bah is, he used to be called Amir al-Mu'mineen fi al-Hadith. He was one of the Tabi'een, or Tabi'een, please, I forgot. From the early Salaf. Great scholar. And one of the most, you know, trustworthy of the ulama of hadith as well. So this is the alim of hadith, the transmitter of the ilm of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, one of the top class. He used to say, rahimahullah ta'ala, as the other ulama related it from him, like Abu Dawood al-Tayalisi and the others, rahimahullah ta'ala, used to say, الإكثار من هذا الحديث يصدكم عن ذكر الله وعن الصلاة. Subhanallah. الإكثار من هذا الحديث. And he is the one who memorized tons of hadith. And he used to say, الإكثار من هذا الحديث. Having a lot of this hadith will keep you away from the dhikr of Allah and from salah. Now what does he mean? How could the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam keep from dhikr and from salah? He must mean something special. So what he meant by that, there are people who follow ilm, who follow information, who follow ilm and knowledge, you know, to have status, and to argue, you know, and to disagree, and to show that I know, without يعني without understanding it, without internalizing it, without having fiqh in it, without acting upon it, without ikhlas in it. Just the idea of compiling and knowing and becoming, you know, somebody that people come to for information. So he says, this is will keep you away from the dhikr of Allah and your salah. And that's why you find some of us who have information and who have quote unquote somewhat which we call knowledge, but in our salah we are so lazy. In our salah we are so in a hurry, so bored. And we don't spend as much time understanding what we know and practicing what we know. But we spend time disseminating what we know for the sake of being said, oh, what a disseminator, or what a speaker, or what a hafiz, or what kada. But we don't internalize it, and we don't practice it hard. So this is the master of hadith saying, يَسُدُّكُمْ عَنْ ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ وَعَنِ الصَّلَاةِ. In other words, do go and learn to practice instead of learning to know. Because knowing is intended to be for practicing our deen. This is not the science of politics or the science of psychology or the science of whatever we call it, other sciences that can be people pursue for the sake of fame or for the sake of this or that. This is deen. Another text teaches one of those ulama, rahimahullah ta'ala, says, متى آلمك عدم إقبال الناس عليك أو توجههم أو توجههم بالذم إليك فارجع إلى علم الله فيك. First of all, this part. متى آلمك عدم إقبال الناس عليك أو توجههم بالذم إليك فارجع إلى علم الله فيك. Allahu Akbar. He beautifully puts it like this, rahimahullah ta'ala. Mata alamaka, what is alam? What is alam? Pain, hurt. Alama is a verb. Mata alamaka, adamu iqbal al-nasi alayk. Whenever, if you have the following feeling and mood and response, if you feel hurt, that people are not coming forward to you. عدم إقبال الناس عليك. By respect or by reverence, or sitting in your majlis of ilm if you're a teacher, or showing you, you know, special celebrating receptions, right? If when that doesn't happen, you feel hurt. If we feel hurt, especially people who have ilm or status or kala. مَتَا أَعْلَمَكَ عَدَمُ إِقْبَالِ النَّاسِ عَلَيْكَ أَوْ تَوَجُّهُهُمْ بِالذَّمِّ إِلَيْكَ أي أَعْلَمَكَ تَوَجُّهُهُمْ بِالذَّمِّ إِلَيْكَ. Or if one feels hurt that they criticize me, that they said something I don't like about me, to me, and I feel hurt. That's the state of my attitude in general and on average. Then he said, if you feel that way, فرجع إلى علم الله بك. Then in that condition that you are, go back in your mind, that is, and in your heart, to what you know that Allah knows about you. Did you see? What does Allah know about you? That's what counts. And that should, for the seeker, it should resolve the conflict inside. Because if what Allah knows about me is what they say and it is true, well, it is true. If I'm worried about them and I'm not worried about Allah, what a fool I am. And if what I know that Allah knows about me and what they say is not true, then kafa billahi shahida. It suffices that Allah knows and witnesses. That's why he says, rahimahullah ta'ala, فَإِنْ كَانَ لَا يُقْنِعُكَ عِلْمُهُ فَمُصِيبَتُكَ بِعَدَمِ قَنَاعَتِكَ بِعِلْمِهِ أَشَدُّ مِنْ مُصِيبَتِكَ بِوْجُودِ الْأَذَى مِنْهُمْ. Because he said, then if with this, it's not enough for you that Allah knows already what you really are, whether they are right or wrong, if this is enough, not enough for you, and you still remain concerned with them, then this is a musibah. This is a calamity in your life. Worse even than your calamity of feeling that they have hurt you. Subhanallah. Is this clear? May Allah help us. It's beautiful. It's powerful. May Allah help us. It speaks to the deepest feelings inside of us. True feelings. And then somewhere else he said, rahimahullah ta'ala, إِنَّمَا أَجْرَ الْأَذَى عَلَىٰ أَيْدِيهِمْ كَيْ لَا تَكُونَ سَاكِنًا إِلَيْهِمْ أَرَادَ أَنْ يُزْعِجَكَ عَنْ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ حتى لا يشغلك عنه شيء. الله أكبر. He said, رحمه الله تعالى, إنما أجر الأذى على أيديهم. Soon we feel hurt again for some reason. That someone else has hurt us. Emotionally or physically or psychologically or intellectually or socially or financially or somebody. And we all have sometimes those feelings, legitimate or illegitimate. So, but he said, rahimahullah ta'ala, إِنَّمَا أَجْرَ الْأَذَى عَلَىٰ أَيْدِيهِمْ. أَجْرَ الْأَذَى, أَذَى is hurt also. And that which we don't like. عَلَىٰ أَيْدِيهِمْ. إِنَّمَا أَجْرَ, that he ran أَذَى, harm, at their hands, through them. Who he? Allah Azza wa Jalla, that's what it is. إِنَّمَا أَجْرَ الْأَذَى عَلَىٰ أَيْدِيهِمْ. Look how he's looking at what happens. He ran, he executed, or he ran the أَذَى to you, the harm to you, through them. In other words, who is the original source? Who is the original source? Allah Azza wa Jalla. إِنَّمَا أَجْرَ الْأَذَى عَلَىٰ أَيْدِيهِمْ كَيْ لَا تَكُونَ سَاكِنًا إِلَيْهِمْ. Allahu Akbar. He did that to you, O seeker of Allah, in order that you do not acquiesce to them. In other words, in order that your relationship in this world with the creatures is not about the creatures. And you feel your heart now going and leaning towards the created world. And you develop too strong of bonds to the created world. So Allah, in His hikmah, decides and wills, but executes through His creatures. So that, the hikmah behind that, is that so that you do not develop unnecessary bonds with the creatures. Allahu Akbar. Your wife, your husband, your colleagues, your friends, not alone, not let alone those who hate you and who hate us. Subhanallah. Innama ajal, the hikmah is very, very positive. So that Allah with this is helping you to do what? To attach to Him, to bond to Him, not to creatures. Because when I'm hurt, even those whom we love most will hurt us in one way or the other. those who love us most will hurt us one way or the other in life. The divine hikmah, he says, rahimahullah ta'ala, behind this, so that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala helps you to be liberated inside of you from them and to bond to Him. أراد أن يزعجك عن كل شيء حتى لا يشغلك عنه شيء. For He wanted by that to make you uncomfortable with everything so that nothing will keep you distracted from Him. Allah Akbar. Allah Akbar. See? Those who know and those who feel رضي الله تعالى عنهم وأرضاهم. And therefore a person like this, his attitude is always, what would you say? Positive. So always positive. Allahu Akbar. But it requires tawheed deep, deep in the qalb. Because these are the details of tawheed. Alaykum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Subhanallah. And that's why he also says, Rahimahullah ta'ala, جَعَلَهُ لَكَ عَدُوًا لِيَحُوشَكَ بِهِ إِلَيْهِ وَحَرَّكَ عَلَيْكَ النَّفْسَ لِيَدُومَ إِقْبَالُكَ عَلَيْهِ. جعله لك عدوا ليحوشك به إليه. جعله, he made him, who made Allah, him who, he made him, جعله لك, as we say what, عدوا, he made it, he made him an enemy to you. Who? Allah made whom an enemy? Shaytan. He made him an enemy to you. And what does the enemy want to do to the one they hate? They want to destroy them. They want always to hurt them. Right? So he says, Rahimahullah ta'ala, جَعَلَهُ جَعَلَهُ عَدُوًا لَكَ لِيَحُوشَكَ بِهِ إِلَيْهِ. In order that he causes you to run away through that to him, as the hujjah. Look at the hikmah, the underlying hikmah. There is shaitan, and shaitan wants to hurt us, to hurt you, to hurt us spiritually and morally especially. And since shaitan is shaitan, alone we can never make it. And when we experience that, if you are seekers of Allah Azza wa Jal, you experience in your life how much you wanted to battle shaitan by you only, and you will not be able to do that. But by him Azza wa Jal. So he made him an enemy to you in order that through that he makes you run to him Azza wa Jal. Allah. وَحَرَّكَ عَلَيْهِ وَحَرَّكَ النَّفْسَ عَلَيْكِ يَدُومَ إِقْبَالُكَ عَلَيْهِ وَحَرَّكَ, as he said, عَلَيْكَ النَّفْسَ لِيَدُومَ إِقْبَالُكَ عَلَيْهِ. And he made your nafs inside of you move and stir to do the wrong things in order that you constantly seek him. Because shaitan and the nafs are our two enemies. Battling against them by our own means, it will never be successful. And Allah made it so. But the beauty in that, He made it so, so that even despite us, many of us, so that we run to Allah. And we keep seeking Him. Because if you practice tazkiyatun nafs, if you practice mujahadatun nafs, If you practice that, you will know for sure how hard it is, no matter how intelligent and how special you are. So with that, as you become more alert of that and more spiritual, you turn more to Allah Azza wa Jal. And turning more to Allah Azza wa Jal is your desire, ultimately, to get closer to Allah. Allahu Akbar. The existence of shaitan and the existence of the nafs, i.e. the bad choices we can choose from, the existence of choice and the wrong choice, the underlying hikmah of that, is to draw nearer to Allah even. To have more momentum to go to Allah and to seek Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Positive attitude. A person like this is always a winner. A person like this is probably never or rarely ever depressed or falls in anxiety or attempts to commit suicide or hurts others. A person like this, Allahu Akbar, is the ultimate beautiful expression of a positive attitude, of a person who is very rich inside. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us be of those who are like that. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, by His merciful love and loving mercy, lead us to Him. May subhanahu wa ta'ala make the difficult things in our way to Him easy for us. And may He conclude our lives and the last moments of our lives in a way that He loves Azza wa Jal, while we are delighted and happy and pleased and longing to encounter Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ameen. Wa sallallahu ala sayyidina wa maulana Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa ashabihi ajma'in. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.